Hello, good morning. So today we are going to study the concept of doubling. We have already finished with the concept of drafting. So let us today try to understand what is doubling. First of all, let us try and understand what is the relation between doubling and unevenness of the output sliver. What happens during doubling and how does it affect the evenness of the output sliver? See, all the textile people are dealing with almost all kinds of irregular or non-uniform material right from the beginning. For example, our raw material for spinning, which is the cotton fibers, say, is not really very uniform in terms of length, trash content, fineness, maturity, or all the other fiber characteristics that we see. So, since the raw material itself has got such a non-uniform characteristics and such a wide range of different characteristics, so it is very difficult to get the same uniformity distributed over the entire length of yarn. And of course, because of that, the yarn also is going to be irregular to a certain extent. As I already mentioned, it happens both because of raw material constraints as well as mechanical constraints. Mechanical constraints means during processing, there may be so many problems that might come up, because of which it introduces some kind of unevenness into the final material or the output material. So because of both the reasons, raw material constraints as well as mechanical constraints, you may find quite a lot of unevenness which has come up in the final yarn. So it is very difficult to get a absolutely regular yarn. Drafting, which is a must for the spinning process throughout, to keep on thinning the material to get the yarn of the required fineness. This drafting process that is there, it will introduce a lot of unevenness, and therefore in the process somewhere we must try to include some kind of operation which will bring about improvement in the evenness of the material. So what we do here is basically doubling. Doubling will try and improve the evenness of the output material. What do we do when we say we are doing doubling? It means that we are feeding several intermediate products together. For example, in case of draw frame, we would feed 6 to 8 slivers that come from card, and we feed them and we get one output sliver. So the scene would look something like this, where we have in the diagram there are shown, there are 5 slivers that are shown, and of course the thick and thin effect has been exaggerated here, but we can try and understand what is exactly happening. Even if we place randomly the slivers just adjacent to each other, next to each other, what we find is every place, for example here, the thick place has come against the thin place. It has just been randomly placed, and we see that to a large extent, the thick place normally comes against the thin place. It very rarely happens that, in very rarely, or it happens with a very small probability that two thick places would try and come together, or two thin places would try and come together adjacent to each other, which might increase the unevenness. But this is a very rare occurrence. So majorly what we find is because of doubling, the irregularity in the final material actually reduces. So this is the basic reason why we go for doubling. Limit. So does it mean that we can keep on feeding, why 6 to 8? Why can't we feed 10 slivers? Why can't we feed 15 slivers at the feed level so that we get better evenness in the final material? So let us see what are the limits that are there to doubling and why they are there basically. So we already know that the moment we say we are going to draft a certain material, it is going to increase the irregularity. And on the other hand, the moment you say I'm going to double or use doubling as a method, what happens is it reduces the irregularity. So these are two contrasting or opposite effects. Draft leads to increase in irregularity and doubling leads to reduction in irregularity. So now, if the number of doublings are increased, for example, suppose I got a draw frame on which I have fed, say, 6 slivers, and now just because I feel that I must try to increase the evenness or get a better regularity in the output sliver, I start feeding 8 slivers. So what will happen is, when I feed 8 slivers, I need to also increase the draft to that level. I mean, I will have to increase the draft, but natural, because if I want to maintain the same thickness as in the first case of the output sliver, then I will have to increase the draft because I have increased number of slivers from 6 to 8. What I have done is, I am feeding a thicker material at the input level. So only if I increase the draft will I be able to maintain the thickness of the output sliver. So the moment I increase doubling, it means that I need to increase the draft also. This is a very practical situation which we have to deal with. Now what will happen if I increase the number of doublings, I may have to increase the draft. So how will it work? The effect of increase in draft and doubling oppose each other, which we saw in the first point here. And therefore, the net effect on irregularity of the output sliver depends upon the dominating factor. That means the irregularity of the output sliver will be decided by which factor would be more dominating in increasing the irregularity, whether it is because of draft or whether it is because of doubling. Whether draft will lead to more increasing irregularity over the effect of reduced irregularity due to doubling, or vice versa. So the net effect will be depending on the both these opposing factors that are there, draft and doubling. So you cannot keep on increasing doubling completely, you know. You cannot say I'll keep on increasing the number of doublings so that I will get better evenness. We should remember that the moment you increase the number of doublings, you will have to also increase the value of the draft, which will lead to increase in irregularity, which is an opposing effect. So now, so what is the limit? So normally we see that on the draw frame, 6 to 8 slivers are fed, and also the draft that is normally applied. If 6 slivers are fed, 6 would be the draft approx. And if 8 slivers are fed, 8 would be the draft that is applied on the draw frame. So there is one more term which you may come across, which is called as a transverse doubling. Now this transverse doubling has some kind of effect on the output material, some positive effects. So let us understand what is transverse doubling. Normally in a passage of making yarn or spinning process, we have two passages of draw frame. Although we say that spinning flowchart is blow room, card, draw frame, speed frame and ring frame, we should understand that after blow room, we will have one passage of card, then there is actually two passage of draw frame, then it will go to speed frame and then ring frame, one machine each. But draw frame, there would be normally two passages, and the first passage is called as a breaker draw frame, and the second passage would be known as a finisher draw frame in the mills. So now we also should know that each draw frame will have two deliveries. That means one draw frame will give two output cans. So now we have got two possibilities here. What we can do is, all the deliveries that come from the first passage, whatever delivery cans are there, those cans are going further straight away to the first delivery of the second passage. And same way for the second. Whatever second delivery of the first passage gives you, that same goes to the second delivery of the second passage. So continuously, it's a straight movement from one draw frame. Those particular cans go to the same delivery or the same feed of the next passage. but you can have a different case also, which will be clearer from this diagram. This is your first passage draw frame. Of course, this is cut over here. There are so many feed cans on either side. And this is what I was talking about, that the draw frame will have two deliveries, delivery number one and delivery number two. And this is your second passage of draw frame. Now, these are both our top views, of course, as you must have guessed. Now, in the earlier case, all these blue slivers would be fed to the first passage here. All would be blue. And here, all yellow would be fed to the yellow. This yellow and blue are just given for the sake of identification. They are almost all the slivers are similar types. So now what happens is, if I feed all these first delivery slivers to the first feed of the second passage, then it would be this case. But in case of transverse doubling, this is what is happening. They are mixed up. Like this first passage, first delivery, this can might go here. So you can see here in the feed of this second passage, you'll see that all kinds of slivers are there. I mean, this blue is also there, yellow is also there, and they're alternately being fed. And all these six slivers will go into the second passage of draw frame, and what you will get is a single output here. And these cans will also give you another single output. So you have two deliveries also for the second passage of draw frame. So this is what we are doing in transverse doubling. We are basically cross feeding by crossover. For example, it's written over here that half of the cans of the first passage could be crossed over in the transverse direction. That means I'm just diagonally, you know, changing its position somehow randomly, and in the transverse direction for feeding to the second passage. Now, what is the advantage, or why should I be doing all this? Because this transverse blending improves in evenness, which is a long-term evenness. With this term, I will explain it in the future lectures whenever we will cover auto-leveling for draw frame. So it improves long-term. For the time being, you understand that transverse blending improves evenness, and it also helps in better blending. So if when I say better blending, suppose imagine that there are, I'm feeding, I'm making a blend, say, of polyester and cotton. So this kind of a transverse, you know, feeding would help blend the polyester and cotton together in a better way. And the homogeneity of the resulting sliver would be better. So this is about transverse doubling. So now let us try and understand actual draft. Because I had to explain doubling before I actually came to this topic of actual draft. We already know what is mechanical draft, which was explained in the last lecture. So here, what first difference between mechanical draft and actual draft is that mechanical draft is calculated by taking values from the machine, whereas actual draft would be calculated by taking the values from the material. So there are two methods of calculating this actual draft. The first method is calculating from the length of the input and the output sliver. So what happens in drafting is that when I feed, say, X length of material, and say the draft is 2, so the output sliver length would be 2 times X. For example, if I'm feeding, say, 1 inch of sliver, if the draft is 2, I would get 2 inches length of sliver, which would be coming out. So the draft, the draft value can be calculated from the length of the sliver, output sliver divided by input sliver. So this is your formula. Actual draft is equal to length of sliver delivered upon length of sliver fed. Now here there is a small question. Just a thought, that suppose instead of one sliver being fed, I feed 6 slivers, or maybe I feed, for the beginning, let me say I'm feeding 2 slivers, each of say 1 inch length, and I put them through the drafting system. The length delivered, not the total length, the length delivered of the output sliver would be how much if the draft is 2? So in this case, we find that even if I feed two slivers or say three slivers or five slivers, it doesn't matter. The moment I draft it, that 1-inch sliver, each one of them is going to be drafted simultaneously, and what I'm going to get is 2-inch sliver if the draft is 2, just like in the previous case. So if I'm feeding 1 sliver, 2 sliver, 10 slivers, it doesn't make a difference to this particular formula. So I do not have to consider number of doublings in this case. Now let us take method 2 for calculating actual draft. So before we go for method 2, I want you to try and remember the definition of kilotex. Just let us revise so that we can use it. What is kilotex? Kilotex is weight in kilograms of 1000 meters of sliver. So when we are calculating from kilotex or hank, there are two ways of calculating again here. If I'm calculating from kilotex, what would be the formula be? Now here, when I'm feeding a say sliver of say, when I say kilotex, suppose 10 kilotex, what does it mean? That this particular sliver of 10 kilotex, 1000 meters of sliver, if I take, it will weigh 10 kgs. So suppose I take two slivers and I feed them. How much would I be feeding? I would be feeding each, agar 10 k, if it is of 10 kilotex, I would be feeding basically 20 kgs per 1000 meters of material. So that is why when I'm calculating actual draft from kilotex, I will have to consider the number of doublings. So my formula becomes actual draft is equal to number of doublings into ktex of input sliver up divided by ktex of output sliver. Why it is input upon output? Because input material is thicker, and after it gets drafted, it will become thinner, and the value, the actual mathematical value of ktex, suppose it was 10 in the beginning, it will become, with a draft of 2, it will become 5. So it will be input sliver upon output sliver. So same formula I can express in hank. Or maybe before going to hank, let us see. This kilotex basically means weight per unit length. If you see the direct system of yarn numbering, ktex comes under direct system, and it is weight per unit length. So it is weight per unit length fed, which is input sliver, and divided by weight per unit length delivered. So all other things are same. Number of doublings we will have to consider even in this case. Or I can calculate this actual draft from hank. So how do I do that? If I were to convert this ktex into hank, this formula just becomes reverse. Actual draft is equal to number of doublings into hank of output sliver divided by hank of input sliver. Why does it become reverse? Because I just give you a hint. We already know this. English count or hank is equal to 590.5 divided by tex. So if I were to replace ktex using this formula, then what I will get is this. So it becomes reverse of this. Here it was input upon output. Here it will be output upon input. So these are the methods of calculating actual draft. Now let us see what is the difference between actual and mechanical drafts. We will first concentrate on the values for draw frame. There are the values of actual and mechanical draft for other machines will vary. The relation between them will vary. Let us see whenever the time comes. So I'm just giving you overall view of how these values are related to each other on different machines. On draw frame, mechanical draft and actual draft will be of the same value, since the draw frame does not remove any part of the material fed in the form of trash or oil. Now in the draw frame, we know that draw frame doesn't clean or remove short fibers or remove trash, nothing. What it does is basically it takes the input material, just drafts it, and through doubling, it will try to improve the evenness and give you the output sliver. There is no removal of any kind of trash or short fibers in the entire process. So that's why in this case, mechanical draft and actual draft will be of the same value. If we were to see the machine like comber, which we will of course learn this semester itself in section 1. In comber, what will happen is short fibers are being removed. These short fibers are also called as noil. It is basically the technical name for short fibers, which is called as noil. So noil will be removed. And since noil is removed during the process, even if you apply a particular mechanical draft by using certain gears or you fix up a mechanical draft, the actual draft that you will be calculating by using the kilotex values of the material that is input and which is come as an output, these values will never match. MD and AD will never match. You will always find that actual draft is more than mechanical draft. The reason being, actual draft will be more because the material has become thinner, more thinner than that was expected. So in this case, it will be AD is more than MD. There is another case also where in spinning only, which is the ring frame. In the ring frame, we are not removing any kind of noil, short fibers. There's nothing being removed. But what happens is we insert twist, and when we insert twist, the output material will become coarser as compared to the input material. So if you were to calculate actual draft using the hank or the tex of the input and output roving and yarn, what you will find is this actual draft value will be more than mechanical draft that you had actually set on the machine. So in this case, it will be AD would be less than mechanical draft. AD values will be less than the mechanical draft values. So, and this happens because you are inserting twist and the material becomes, output material becomes coarser. So each one of this we will see in detail when we come to comber or in the next sem when we come to ring frame. So no need to worry about these two right now. For the time being, we should understand, although that we have learnt what is mechanical draft, what is actual draft, the values of actual and mechanical draft in case of draw frame will be the same. So we need not worry for the time being. Only thing we should know that these terms exist. So here we come to an assignment that I would like you to complete. It is just one problem which covers everything that we have learned till now. It also tests you on how to calculate draft, how to calculate draft constant when CP is given, which was yesterday's lecture, and it will also help you understand how to calculate new CP when your draft value changes. So this is one problem that I would like you to try as an assignment, and if there are any problems, of course I'm there to solve it. Also, there is one more problem that I would like you to try. It is somewhat of a higher level. It is slightly more difficult than the previous problem, but I would like you to give it a try. Here the hint is, I would like to give you a hint. The hint would be to convert hank into ktex first, or rather ne to ktex first. In the problem, if you see, there are values of the sliver which are given in ne, okay, and to produce, the output value is given in ktex here. So what I would like, that's a hint. What I want you to do is first convert these two into ktex. So that would be a sort of practice for you of conversion from one system to the other, and then try to solve both these questions that are there. Okay, so first of all, try to understand the problem. Of course, if again, since you this would be slightly difficult for you, I would be clearing it maybe in the coming lectures, but I would like you to try it out. So I would give you more time, maybe a week's time, for you to try and solve this problem. The previous assignment that is there, I would want it maybe this weekend itself. But this one, I'll give you more time, maybe a week's time to try and solve this. Okay, so we stop here. Thank you. And as usual, we will be meeting on tomorrow. Thank you.